JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for May the 12th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar traded higher against all the other G10 currencies on Friday, Monday, and during the Asian morning Tuesday. It gained the most versus NOK, Aussie, and SEK in that order, while it eked out the least gains versus the Swiss franc. The relative strength of the US dollar and the Swiss franc, combined with the weakening of the Aussie and Kiwi, suggests that market sentiment was subdued. That said, the fact that the Japanese yen was the fourth loser in line points otherwise. Thus, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world in order to get a better picture with regards to the broader investor morale. Here, most major EU indices traded in negative waters, while later Wall Street traded mixed. The Dow Jones Industrial Average slid 0.45%, but Nasdaq gained 0.78%. The S&P 500 closed virtually unchanged. Investors' appetite deteriorated again during the Asian morning today. Although Japan's Nikkei closed virtually unchanged, by now China's Shanghai Composite, Hong Kong's Hang Seng, and South Korea's KOSPI are down 0.16, 1.50, and 0.22% respectively. What hurt the broader market sentiment may have been news that Germany and South Korea reported an acceleration in new coronavirus infections, which may have raised concerns over a second wave of exponential spreading of the virus. Fresh tensions between China and the US may have also dented sentiment. Early in the day, reports suggested that the US was preparing to issue a warning that China is working to steal the US research on coronavirus vaccines, while during the Asian morning today, following reports that China was considering renegotiating the phase one trade deal, US President Trump said that he doesn't want something like that. Now, as for our view, despite the acceleration in Germany's and South Korea's infections, the cases on a global scale have been in a slowdown mode, and we can see that on the graph here where I present the daily change of deaths and cases on a day-by-day basis. Barring any further negative headlines surrounding the US-China trade front, we would expect risk appetite to rebound again in the following days, if not today. In other words, we expect equities to drift north again and safe havens to come under renewed selling interest. That said, today market participants may pay extra attention to the US CPIs for April. Headline inflation is expected to have slowed to 0.4% year over year from 1.5%, while the core rate is forecast to have declined to 1.7% from 2.1%. Although this suggests that the fall in the headline rate may be mainly owed to the collapse in oil prices, a core rate below the Fed's objective of 2% could keep the door open for further easing by the Fed. Last week, the yields of the Fed funds futures turned negative, suggesting that some investors believed that the Fed could make the exception and cut interest rates into negative waters. However, yesterday, Atlanta Fed President Rafael Bostic and Chicago Fed President Charles Evans said that they don't anticipate such a, they don't anticipate such a move, something that pushed the negative yields back to near zero. Thus, it remains to be seen whether slowing inflation will revive speculation for such an action, despite the Fed never being in favor of the negative rates regime. The big question is how the market will react on a possible inflation slowdown. Will equities come under selling interest, or will they rise on expectations of more stimulus? We believe that the latter is more likely, as the global stimulus efforts from the monetary and fiscal fronts worldwide, alongside the easing of the stay-at-home measures and the prospect of a vaccine being ready for distribution soon, have been the drivers of the latest recovery in sentiment. Now, as for tonight, during the Asian session Wednesday, we have a central bank deciding on monetary policy, and this is the RBNZ. A couple of weeks ago, the kiwi came under strong selling pressure after Westpac said it expects the RBNZ to cut interest rates to minus 0.5% in November, a move that could be telegraphed as early as in August. They also said that they expect officials to double their QE program to 60 billion kiwis at this gathering. That said, last week the employment data for the first quarter came in better than expected. The unemployment rate ticked up to 4.1% from 4%, while the forecasts while the forecast was for a rise to 4.3%. The employment change showed a 0.7% gain in jobs instead of a 0.3% decline as the forecast suggested. This may have alleviated some pressure for policymakers to act again as soon as at this gathering, but it still remains to be seen whether they will decide to double their QE purchases or not. In case they do, the QE is likely to come under renewed selling interest and could even underperform this Australian counterpart due to monetary policy divergence. Remember that last week, the RBA kept interest rates unchanged, but announced that it has scaled back the size and frequency of its own bond purchases. Now, as for the rest of today's events, in the US, besides the US CPIs, we have four more Fed speakers scheduled to speak. Those are St. Louis Fed President James Bullard, Minneapolis Fed President Neil Kashkari, Philadelphia President Patrick Harker, and Board Governor Randall Quarles. We will pay extra attention to these speeches, as it would be interesting to hear those officials' opinions on negative interest rates. With regards to the energy market, we get the American Petroleum Institute weekly report on crude oil inventories, but as it is always the case, no forecast is available. As for tonight, during the Asian morning Wednesday, apart from the RBNZ decision, we also have Australia's wage price index for the first quarter. Expectations are for wages to have grown by 0.5% quarter over quarter, the same pace as in the fourth quarter of 2019, something that would take the year-over-year rate a tick lower to 2.1% from 2.2%. In our view, a downtick in the year-over-year rate is unlikely to prompt RBA policymakers to scale up their QE purchases, although they noted they could do so if deemed necessary. With the spreading of the coronavirus leveling off, they may continue to scale back their program if data continue to allow so. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.